Next, we're going to create a power grid. So after we ran the special route commands, the power and ground rails are connected. So the core ring is connected to the top level PG pins, and follow pins are routed and connected to the core ring. But for a robust power distribution, we need to build a power grid or a power mesh, depending on how you want to call it. And we do this with the add stripes command, or the add stripes form. And again, this is another one of these forms with a lot of options and a command with a lot of options on it. So for example, we can add stripes. We want to add M2 stripes that go along our design. What we want these stripes to do is connect at the top and the bottom to the ring in M1. And we want it to drop vias every time the VDD stripe goes over the VDD follow pin. We want it to drop vias. And every time the ground stripes goes over the ground follow pin, we want it to drop vias. And this is what the add stripes command does automatically. So I do add stripes minus nets VDD ground, layer metal 2. I decide on the width and the spacing of these stripes. I decide where I want to start from and what the distance between them is, and so forth. And so really what you're going to usually do is going to have this buildup of many, many different nets that go up. It could be in every layer. It could be just a lot at the top layers and just a couple at, something like M2 and M3. But we're going to have some sort of power mesh that we're going to build all over our design. Here are some notes about power grids. So the add stripes command is very powerful. It can create PG stripes according to many parameters. It'll automatically drop via arrays between stripes on different layers, and it will connect to macro PG pins when possible. So it's really a cool command, and it does a lot of things, and it can solve us a lot of headaches. But how do we know how much power routing is needed? Which layers to use? How wide should we make them? What offsets to use between them, and so forth and so on? Well, these are multi-million dollar questions. Really, there is not a perfect answer here, and this is really a hard thing to actually relate to. So the golden answer is you want to have as many PG stripes as possible while enabling signal routing. So you don't want to cause congestion because you filled up your whole layer with power and ground stripes. So this is a trade-off. The more power and ground stripes we're going to put on, we're going to get better IR drop. And better electromigration. But then again, we're not going to have as much room to use as many routing resources to route our signals with. So this is a big problem. And, they say that the blanket is very short. You can only pull from one side and keep the blanket on the other side for a certain amount of pull. Okay, so that's the golden answer. And so the reality is that we're going to kind of guess and iterate. So what you do is you create a power mesh and run through the flow and you check routability. So you see if the power mesh you create can route, and you're going to run EMIR analysis. So for example, the tool Voltus will run EMIR analysis, and it will expose problems. There are early rail analysis flows, and there are post layout analysis flows. I'm not showing them again in this course, but it's a very important thing to do and a really important tool. And then if we find problems, we're going to go and iterate through this. This is why floor planning is a long process, and it takes a long time for the backend guys to actually set it up. So at this point now we have our physical cells added to the floor plan, and we want to complete our power mesh by adding stripes. So I'm just going to show you stripes on metal 2 that are going to connect the top ring to the bottom ring. But in general, you would make a power mesh that would go up to higher metal layers. And when you would add the metal layers, it would add via stacks that connect between them. So that is done here under the power menu. And there's power planning, and we have add stripes under add rings. Okay, and again, we see there are lots of options here. We can select the nets that we want to route, the global nets we want to route, and what metal layer we want to route in, what direction they are, the width and spacing of the nets, the set-to-set distance between them, and many, many other options. All of these options are, of course, in the add stripes command. So let's go over to the add stripes command, and we have an example over here. Okay, so add stripes minus layer, and we give the layer. I didn't write M1 or M2. Instead, I wrote lindex getdb layers name 1. So just let's see that as an example. So getdb layers name is going to, dot name is going to return all the layers that we have in this technology, because they could be called other things other than M1. It could be metal 1, metal 2, or maybe other types of names. And I want, this is a list, so I want to get one of the options in the list. So that returned M2. So I used that in order to kind of abstract away the actual technology. So then I could just say the second metal layer is going to be routed. The direction is going to be vertical. parameter is for M2 stripes, what the spacing between them is, where do I start? So what's the offset from the left side that I start with? What's the set-to-set distance? Do I create pins on them? And the max same layer jog length. Okay, so I'm going to run that. And again, there's going to be lots of options for add stripes. And it ran it very quickly. Again, this could take a longer time with a more complex design. And I got these two stripes over here. And they're nice via connections. Okay, you see the nice vias that it made between the M2 layer and the M3 that's above it. And of course, after I do such a thing, it's always worth checking the DRCs. And I still see that I have zero violations, so that's very good. So we finished our floor plan, and we can now create our stage reports if we want to. We can decide what we want to report out and where it should be reported. So those things are going to be like in reports. Now we have floor plan reports, and we've got some reports that we should look at and go over. There's nothing fancy about them right now with our very simple design. Okay, once we finish that, we are going to write out a def. A def file is a file that describes all of the things that we have currently in our design. At this point, it's just going to be the floor plan objects, which include the special routes, the floor plan size, the cells, etc. And that we can take back into Genus to use as a floor plan for our physical synthesis, for example. So I'm going to write out the def over here. Okay, and it tells me that I wrote out the def over to what design floor plan def was. We can take a look at that. So it's going to be under export, okay, and then SM floor plan def. And we see that it's going to tell me where all the rows are, the different tracks we have, cell grids, all kinds of special rules we have over here inside, and just a whole bunch of stuff about what we have inside here, the different vias we made, end caps that we put in, where the pins are. So it's everything we needed to know about the floor plan is here, and we can also reload the floor plan using the def file later on if we want to. Okay, so that was our def file, and we saved that out. Next, we go over to check connectivity, which is a type of an LVS checker. I wouldn't call it an LVS checker, but it's a poor man's LVS checker, and at least at the Innovus level, it checks the connectivity between all the different types of net. It primarily reports opens and shorts. It does report all kinds of other things, but really the thing that we can use most is the open and short type of violations it shows us. It's based on the abstracts, the lefts of the tool, so it doesn't check anything beyond the pin connectivity. Anything that's inside the GDS is not checked here. You have to run LVS with a real LVS tool that's GDS based and not based on these lefts. This can really sometimes report confusing errors, so you want to use appropriate flags. Depending on what stage of the design you're on, you're going to get a lot of errors. For example, if we run check connectivity before we've actually done routing, obviously things aren't going to be connected. So if we want to do something like check connectivity during floor plan, we would use something like minus type special, and then it will only check the connectivity of the special routes, and then it can show us if some of the special routes were not connected, some piece of VDD is not shorted to the whole VDD grid or something like that. So you want to really run this check connectivity with the appropriate flags for the appropriate stage of the design that you're on.